In a way, it's like that post-traumatic growth thing. You do things after that trauma and loss that you never imagined you would ever do before. I would never be facilitating a group of any sort if Zeta hadn't have died.
You gave a really good description of that, and you mentioned that we are accidental experts, and we are.
Qualified by experience.
When we started the group, we decided that we were going to put some guidelines in place. I mean, you know, we're coming into this, you know, blind from where I was standing, because, you know, there was no group, so we're starting it off. But we knew that you need to put something in place that people could follow and agree to. And we give them to people before they come along, and we say to them, have a look at these, see what you think. And when you come along to the first session, we'll talk about these, and as a collective group of people, we'll agree, disagree, change whatever we say. But as long as we get that collective that agrees to what happens, you know, the respect that everyone can say something, confidentiality, what says in the room stays in the room, and just that general ability just to be open and honest about what you want to bring to the group.
When I started my group, at first I didn't have any rules, I didn't have anything. It was about bringing everyone together so we can get to know each other, make that connection and share our stories. No rules, you know. We had a set time, you know. The meeting started at 6 and finished at 8. And what we did in that time was get to know each other. And if any decisions were going to be made or what we're going to do, it was up to all of them in the group to make those decisions, not me. Because this was about all of us and for everyone to come together and share. And how we did things, it was about respecting each other. I think the main things, though, when I first started was keeping people safe and making sure they were comfortable. And, yes, their confidentiality, like you brought up, important things.
Mm. And you used the word respect, eh? If you had that as a number one kind of a guideline or rule in your group, then you know.
Mm-hmm.
Just another thought that I had about group rules and guidelines is that I think that they're just one kind of tool or one way that you that in our group that we've created a kind of culture of care and compassion and non-judgment. But obviously there's a whole lot of other things that happen in a group that help to create that kind of culture. But I think that group rules or guidelines can kind of just be a support to that.
When we started the group, one of the things that came up was, where are we going to hold this? I mean, a venue. We thought about our places and then we thought, we really need something neutral. At the time we were quite lucky because Teresa had worked for this lady who had these rooms. And she actually offered these rooms to us. I think it's important that you know, the basic thing, you have that kitchen or somewhere to make a cup of tea.
Yeah.
I mean, and so people can stand around and talk as well. You know, it just make it as comfortable and relaxing for people as possible.
I think it can take huge courage for people to come along to a group. And or particularly starting off, but on an ongoing basis, it's a courageous thing to do. And so the space, I think, to have a space that people can walk into, that's a nice space, that's a welcoming, warm space, is really important. Yeah.
I've also got a support group on Facebook, and every month, the first of every, I always put a message on there to all those whānau who are celebrating a birthday or an angelversary or the loss of a loved one. We're here to support you, we're here for you.
For Solace Auckland, our funding is, well, we don't have any funding, official funding, so we've had a lot of kind donations from places like Rotary, and people will donate. Long-serving members will often get a check or some sort of donation from them, which is pretty amazing. And at each meeting we have a gold coin donation to cover the bickies and the tea and coffee, and it's surprising actually how much we get from that. We also have a end of year candle lighting service, which is where we sort of do our big fundraising. So we literally pass a big bucket around the church and say to people, donate, this helps our group continue. So people tend to be as generous as they can.
How do you let people know about the group?
Because we've been going 15 years, it's kind of it's sort of known in the community and sector. We citizen advice bureaus are really good, and the victim support network is vital. They often refer people to us, and funeral homes do as well, and through the Mental Health Foundation website, and it's sort of out there. People, when they want a support group, they'll find you, you know, which is amazing.